So yesterday we had seen we had started with coating. In coating, we had finished with sugar coating yesterday, and then we started with film coating. In film coating, we have seen that you require a coating composition, okay? And we had seen that there are different types of film coating. They are non-enteric film coating, enteric film coating, sustained release film coating, modified release film coating, and controlled release film coating. If you see the literature, there are basically two types of film coating. That is non-enteric film coating and enteric film coating. Okay, and then the others may be there in the literature or may not be there in the literature. Okay, then we went on further to see, the difference between a film coating and what is the difference between a sugar coating and film coating. We went on further to see about the coating composition, and there we saw if you want to do film coating, then you have to prepare a solution. Okay, and that is made up from film formers, which are polymers. They again are of two types. You have non-enteric film forming agents and you have enteric film forming agents. Apart from that, you require solvents, you require pigments, you have required plasticizers and opacifying agents. Yesterday, we have seen about the film formers, both the non-enteric film forming agents also we have seen, and we have seen about the enteric film forming agents also, and we have seen about the solvents also. Today, we are going to see about the pigments, plasticizers and opacifying agents. And then we are going to see some problems and remedies that are there with coating. Okay. Moving ahead about the film forming agents, we studied yesterday that there are two types of film forming agents. One is a non-enteric film forming agent, and second is the enteric film forming agents. We started with the non-enteric film forming agents, and we said there are different types of non-enteric film forming agents. The examples that we have seen was we had seen the examples of HPMC, then we have seen the examples, we have seen MHEC, we have seen about ethyl cellulose, we have seen about hydroxypropyl cellulose, we have seen about povidone, and we have seen about acrylic polymers. Here we have seen their solubility profile, we have seen what are the disadvantages with these kinds of polymers. We have also seen some peculiar how they are manufactured. Is there some peculiar way, peculiar pattern in which they can be manufactured? Okay, and we have also seen their the different trade names and the way in which they are available inside the market. Then we went on to see the enteric film forming agents, and when we are seeing the enteric film forming agents, we first saw what are the reasons for doing an enteric coating. Where we saw that it can be done in order to protect the drug, it can be done in order to protect the gastric mucosal membrane, it can be done in order to have local action, it can be enteric coating can be done in order to have maximum absorption if it is there from the small intestine, okay, to take the advantage of that, or it can be also done in order to have a delayed release of the drug, okay. Then we went on to the different film forming agents, in which that we saw that phthalate group is a very important group. So we saw the first compound, which is traditionally very widely used, that was cellulose acetate phthalate. Then we went on to see about the acrylate polymers. We have seen Utragit L and Utragit S. These are the two polymers which have been used. We saw HPMC phthalate, which has been used. Then we saw about PVPA, okay. And then also we went on further. The year we completed our film forming agents, both enteric and non-enteric film forming agents we have covered with. Okay. Then we went on further to see about the solvents. In solvents, we have first seen the function of the solvent. It was what? Nothing but to disperse or dissolve not only the polymers but also the other components which we are going to see today. That is about the colors, the opacifying agents, okay. The plasticizers, it should be able to either dissolve or you should be able to disperse, okay, and prepare a solution or a solvent out of these material whatever we are adding to the solvent system, so that we can easily spray with the help of the gun onto the tablet surface or the granule surface. We further went on to see what are the ideal requirements from a solvent, where we saw that it either should dissolve or it should perform its function. What is this function? To dissolve or disperse the polymer. So you should do that. It should not harm the environment. Okay. And then it should not only dissolve or disperse the polymers, but also the coating solution. It should have a very hard high drying rate. Okay, whereby the solvents get evaporated very faster. Okay, and it should have other properties just like colorless, tasteless, odorless. It should be inexpensive. It should be non-toxic. It should be inert. It should be non-inflammable. Okay, these all properties are also required from the solvent. We have seen some examples of solvents yesterday, where we saw water and we saw its advantages and disadvantages. Okay, and we saw other organic and inorganic solvents also, and we also saw its advantages and disadvantages. Okay, moving ahead with the polymeric composition, okay, along with the film formers, that is enteric or non-enteric, whatever you are using, along with these polymers, okay, in the solvent system, you also add your plasticizers. Now, what are plasticizers? Plasticizers give the flexibility to this polymeric film. Okay, just for example, if I prepare a polymeric film, if I prepare a patch, supposing just for example, I am preparing a Tarzan bull patch. Okay, I am preparing a buccal patch. If I don't add plasticizers, okay, then what is going to happen? First of all, the film may not be formed. Okay, and even if the film is getting formed, then it is going to be very brittle in nature. Okay, what does plasticizers do? It gives the flexibility, or it gives the plasticity to the film that is getting formed onto the tablet. So what we are actually doing is we are having a tablet, and on that tablet we are forming a film onto that tablet. When we are forming the film onto the tablet, we want that it should be flexible in nature. If it is flexible in nature, then only it is going to form a film onto the tablet surface. This plasticity is imparted by the plasticizers. Okay, so it modifies the quality of the film. There are two types of plasticizers that are existing. Okay, when you have internal plasticizers and external plasticizers. What are internal plasticizers? In internal plasticizing, what we do is we modify the basic polymer, okay, in such a way that the physical property of the polymer is getting modified and it becomes flexible. So there is some chemistry involved into it, okay, whereby you are changing the polymer into a plasticized kind of a polymer, okay. So it is a chemical modification, right? Not that much important from our point of view. What we are studying is the plasticizers which can be added externally. Okay, so these are known as external plasticizers. So along with your film formers, you are adding them into the solution. So along with your cap, you are adding them. Along with the ethyl cellulose, you are going to add them. So what it is going to give is it is going to form a flexible film, right? So that is what it is going to do. Secondly, what it is going to do is these agents, when you add them, they are going to increase the tensile strength of the film. The strength of the film is getting increased. I'll just give you an example, one more example. Just take the plastic. Okay, you have a plastic bag. Okay, take that plastic bag and pull it. Okay, what it is going to happen? Some plastic bags are going to break immediately. You just pull it and they break. So you can say the tensile strength, they are not having that much of tensile strength. Whereas to take another plastic bag, a piece of plastic, and you pull it, it goes on stretching, it goes on stretching up till a point, and then it breaks. The more it gets stretched for a longer period of time, then we can say that it is having a very good tensile strength. If it breaks immediately, then it does not have the tensile strength. So plasticity gives that flexibility and it gives a tensile strength, okay, into the polymeric film that is getting formed onto the tablet, okay, or granules. Okay, and it also increases, plasticizer sometimes also increases the adhesive property, whereby the film can stick onto the tablet, right? So this is the role of the plasticizers. So what we are doing is we are using external plasticizers. We are adding it into the coating solution in order to have flexibility, tensile strength, and in order to have the adhesive property. Now, what is the quantity of plasticizer that has been added? The quantity of plasticizer added ranges from 1 to 50% by weight of film formers. Now, what are film formers? Those non-enteric and enteric film formers. Whatever is the percentage of that, uska 1 to 50% can be used in order to have plasticizing. Okay. Now, just to tell you about, the plasticizers and how the plasticizers act may not be important from your theoretical point of view, but just to give you the idea how the plasticizers act, are these plasticizers, they actually what they do is they sit into the, you have the polymeric structure. They go and sit inside this polymeric structure. Okay, they get attached to this polymeric structure. You must have seen your 12th standard teacher, he's trying to change the structure. Okay, sometimes he is able to change the structure, and sometimes the model that he prepares is able to rotate, and sometimes he's not able to rotate the model. You must have seen that he doing it in the 12th standard. Okay, when he's not able to rotate the structure, it is nothing but the structure is very rigid in nature. Okay, and when he's able to rotate the structure, you can say the structure is not rigid in nature. In the similar manner, these plasticizers, they are also nothing but a chemical compound, a long change of the chemical compounds, isn't it? When these polymers, when these plasticizers go and sit inside this structure, okay, what happens is the structure earlier, which was very rigid in nature, which was not moving, is now able to move. And that imparts the plasticity to the whole polymeric chain and then to the film. Okay. The example, some of the examples are castor oil. All that ends with all, you have to remember. It means propylene glycol, it ends with all. Glycerine, which is also known as glycerol. Okay. So polyethylene glycol, propylene glycol, glycerol, all that ends with all. Okay. These all are the examples of your plasticizers, along with castor oil, surfactants such as polysorbates, which are known as twins, or sorbitol esters, which are known as pans. So twins, pans, organic acid, some of the organic acid esters can also be used. But the most important are propylene glycol, glycerol, that is glycerine, and your polyethylene glycol. I just forgot to mention it over here, but polyethylene glycol, also PEG. Okay. So these are some of the examples of the plasticizers which impart plasticity to your film, and hence they are added into the coating solution. Okay. Now moving ahead, now let us see something about the next important ingredient, that is color. Why is color added? Because first it gives the distinctive appearance to your tablet, so it become very, very easier. And secondly, it increases the elegance of your product. So that is the one of the reasons why you're doing your coating. Okay. So now how it is done is have the proper distribution. What you do is you suspend these colorants in the coating solution. Okay. Hence, they are required in a very fine powdered form, right? So they should be in a very fine powder form. That is the basic requirement from these colorants. Usually less than 10 micron size, okay, should be there in order to achieve this proper distribution of your colorants inside the coating solution. We have seen this earlier also, that if you want to have a proper no mottling effect, or you want a proper distribution of color, you want the best color to be achieved, for that what you should have is you should have a very less micron size. Okay, so that can be achieved by micronization, and this micron size, less than 10 micron size coloring agents, then further can be added into your solvent system. Okay. Now the concentration depends upon many things. Okay, the concentration that you are achieving of this colorant, okay, in the coating solution, they depend upon many things. They depend upon the color shade, right? If you want a very light color shade, then you are going to add less quantity of your colorant. If you want to have a dark shade, then you are going to add a high quantity of your colorant. It also depends upon the dye that you are using. Okay, some dye have to be used in a very less quantity, whether you're using a dye or a lake, that it also depends upon that also. So if you are using a dye, then you have to use in a less quantity, sorry, in more quantity. If you are using a lake, then you have to use in a less quantity. Okay, and it also depends upon the concentration of the opacifying agents, which you are going to see after this. If you are adding more opacifying agent, and if you want to have a darker shade, then you have to add more concentration of your colorant. Opacifying agent usually decreases the shade of the color. It gives a little bit amount of matte finish. So if you are adding opacifying agent, then you have to increase the concentration of your color that you are adding into the solvent. Okay. So as I said, it depends upon the color shade. It depends upon the type of dye that you are using. It depends upon the dye or lake that you are using. Or it also depends upon the opacifying agent. Okay, so this is what I have written over here also, that for a very light shade, the concentration which is less than 0.01% can be used. But if you want to have a dark shade, then the concentration that is required to be used is more than 2%. Now, these kinds of colorants can be used, okay, the colorants that are certified by FDA, okay, Food and Drug Cosmetic Act has given you the list of colorants, only those colorants can be used. What does this FDC stand for? F stands for food. If some colorant is having written on it as FDC, it means what? It is good for food also, it is good for drug also, and it is good for cosmetic also. If there is some colorant which is mentioning only D and C, it means that colorant is good as a drug also, and it is good for use in cosmetic also. Okay, so you can use FDC color or you can use DNC color. The colorants come with the name, and in further in the bracket they would have given you whether it is an FDC color or it is an DNC color. Okay, that they must have mentioned on it. As I told you earlier, colorants, as you are aware, you must have studied in your first year, second year, that they are classified as lakes and dyes. Just to revise you, dyes are nothing but they are water soluble, isn't it? And they come in the form of powders, granules, or liquids. Whereas if we take lakes, lakes are not water soluble and they are found in products containing fats and oils. Okay, so this is in order to differentiate between your lakes and dyes. So this is about the colorants that you are going to use. Some of the examples of inorganic material that are used as colorants, or some of the natural coloring agents that are available are, and which are being used traditionally, are iron oxides, caramels are there, carotenoids are there, chlorophyll, indigo, flavones, okay, turmeric and carminic acid. Okay, these all colorants can be used. Sukesh has asked me a question: is excessive quantity of colorant toxic? If you are using a good quality color, then it will not be that much toxic, but the quantity, as we have seen, is very less. Siddhesh, as I told you to one of your earlier questions, that you don't add anything in excess, or you don't add anything in less quantity. You add whatever is optimum for it. These all colors are they are being approved by FDNC, okay, by the regulatory bodies, okay, and only those colors can be used. So those are basically non-toxic if used in adequate quantity. For that matter, anything, okay, all these, whether you take a drug, okay, drug, if also used in excess quantity, is toxic in nature. You know it very well. So these all are chemical, whether you take a lubricant, whether you take a glidant, whether you take a colorant, whether you take an opacifying agent, whatever you take, these all are chemicals, right? So they are going to harm your body as such. If you use it in a, we are onto the inorganic material that can be used and the natural colorants that can be used. If you said that iron oxide, caramel, carotenoids, chlorophyll, indigo, flavones, turmeric, and carminic acid. Okay, these are the agents that can be used, okay, as the colorants. Then we have seen there are some commercially available colorants also, synthetically manufactured. Some of the examples are opalex, okay, it is a opaque color. And it is very useful, very much useful in the sugar coating. You have opa spray, okay, which is very much useful for film coating, and you have opa dry, okay. This is a colorant which can dry very fast, okay, and it is also used in film coating. Okay, these are some of the commercially available colorants. Moving ahead to the last compound that is added in coating composition is your opacifying agents. Okay, now opacifying agents, these are fine organic powders, okay, which are used in your coating solution in order to have most pastel kind of in colors, okay, and it also increases the film coverage. So these are the two reasons for it: in order to have the matte kind of a finish, in order to have pastel colors, not to have very light and bright colors. If you don't want to have very light and bright colors, okay, if you want to have a matte finish, then these opacifying agents can be used. Another major use of opacifying agent is it increases the film coverage. So a little bit quantity of colors, okay, can give you a very nice film coverage. For that also, it is being used. Now, what does this opacifying agents do is, it provides white coating, or it masks the color of the tablet core also. So if you are If your tablet core is having some color, if your drug itself is colored, or if your excipient is colored, then what it is going to do is it is going to mask that color, and whatever is your color, it is going to have a very good coverage onto it, onto that white coat. Okay, so that is the reason. That is another reason for which the opacifying agents have been used. The examples are titanium dioxide, silicates, okay, like talc, aluminum silicates can be used. Then carbonates can be used, like magnesium carbonate, sulfates like calcium sulfates can be used. Okay, so these are different opacifying agents that can be added to your coating solution. Okay, so up till now we have seen how a how a